Friday the 13th, The Mask of Jason Voorhees, Chapter 8, The Diaries. It had been over an hour since Ryan had gone to bed. Unfortunately for Micki, she was too energized from the events of the evening to even consider sleep. So she sat at the kitchen table, going over Pamela Voorhees' diaries. She figured, given her own experience keeping a journal, that if Pamela left any clues as to how Jason was originally resurrected, then she would have written them here. She decided to start with the entries just after Jason drowned. So far, all she found was the emotional outpouring of a distressed mother. Then she read an entry that sounded uncomfortably familiar. Journal entry, August 19, 1957. Today I sat once again in my child's room crying, but today Elias barged in on me. I cannot believe the gall of the man. He practically ordered me to stop mourning my precious boy. How dare he? Then, to add insult to injury, he inferred that I had done the unthinkable with my own brother, and that my poor Jason wasn't really his son. What would put such thoughts in his head? Oh, Lewis, I know, given Elias's horrid accusations, it is wrong, but I wish you were here. I need your comfort and understanding. I know that you can make things better. Micki started skimming through the entries in the hope of finding another reference to Lewis. That's where she found September 15, 1957. A sense of calm has overcome me. Today I got a letter from Lewis. Surprisingly, it came all the way from Canada. Lewis informed me that he'd started a business in Montreal with a friend of his. He said he was selling antiques for special clients. To my surprise, he wrote that he had acquired an item that might be of some help to me, though he didn't go into what exactly the item was. Though I doubt anything can help me, I must admit I'm curious as to what this item is. A chill ran down Mickey's back. She knew any item associated with Lewis had to be cursed. Anxiously, she began to skim over the entries. She went through about a month and a half worth of entries before she found what she was looking for. November 4th, 1957. Today, Lewis's parcel arrived. I had thought it would come through the regular post, but, to my surprise, it came in the possession of a teenage Negro boy. I was salting the walkway to the house because of the coming of an early snow when the boy arrived. It was like he appeared out of nowhere. He very politely asked me my name and handed me the heavy paper-bound parcel. He introduced himself as Creighton Duke and said Lewis had sent him. He also said that Lewis would get in touch with me shortly. After the young man went on his way, I took the parcel in the house and opened it. To my shock, I found that underneath the wrapping was a book, the most horrifying-looking volume I'd ever seen in my life. The book appeared to be bound in the flesh from a human face. I opened the book and found the pages looked to be made of dried human flesh as well. As I looked through a few pages, I found that they were covered in horrifying pictures, with text written in a language I was unfamiliar with. I had little doubt that the ink used to draw these pictures and write these words was made from human blood. After looking over the book some more, I hid it in my trunk along with my other personal items, afraid that Elias might find it. Oh, to whatever gods created this abomination, that does not happen. Now all I can do is wait for Lewis to contact me and explain how such a horror could possibly be of help to me. Micki continued to skim through the diary, now more determined to learn more. She recognized the description of the book Pamela mentioned as that of one of the fabled copies of the Necronomicon, though she had thought they were pure myth. Obviously, she had been mistaken. After several more pages and near a month's worth of entries, she came upon what she was looking for. December 6th, 1957. Finally, my waiting has been rewarded. I heard from Lewis. Once again, I was outside shoveling the walkway when the young Negro boy, Creighton Duke, surprised me again by seeming to appear out of nowhere. Silently, he handed me a note and walked off into the snow again. I opened the note and was excited to see Lewis's handwriting. The note instructed me to meet him inside a cave on the western slope of Crystal Hill at midnight in 2 days from now. He also instructed me to bring the book with me. A thrill went through Micki as she read these words. Quickly, she moved ahead 3 days, hoping Pamela would mention something about her meeting with Lewis. She was not disappointed. December 9th, 1957. Last night I met with Lewis. It was easy since Elias and I have not slept in the same bedroom for months, and he always turns in early. The only hard part was making the long trip through the snow to Crystal Hill. Thankfully, when I finally reached the cave, Lewis was there with a warm greeting. He'd had Creighton Duke prepare a comfortable fire in the center of the cave. The boy was also present at our meeting, though he stayed in the corner of the room and silently observed us. After seating me in a folding chair near the fire, Lewis asked me to give him the book. After I handed it to him, he explained to me that it was important for what we must do that I be in possession of the book. After glancing through the book, Lewis stopped at one page. He looked up at me and explained that in recent years, he'd become involved with some ancient beings known only as the Ancient Ones. He told me that since God would not help me, he had convinced them to help me by restoring my son to me. Then he went on to tell me that there was a series of rituals required to perform this miracle. I was aghast and fascinated as Lewis told me about the different sacrifices the Ancient Ones needed to help build the energy to do their work. Though I must admit to a strong feeling of satisfaction when Lewis told me of the final sacrifice. To bring my son back to me, I would have to take the lives of the two camp counselors who let my son drown. It would be through their hearts and blood that things would be put right. It was at this point that Micki stopped reading. She headed upstairs and got a yellow highlighter pen from her duffel bag, where she carried her research tools. Then she headed downstairs and started reading again. As the hours went by, Micki went through and highlighted the shocking details of the various rituals Pamela had to endure. Several of the rituals dealt with the gathering of various body fluids, skin, and hair scrapings from both her and Lewis. Other rituals, which she was forced to do on her own, dealt with the sacrifice of various animals, bugs, and birds. The blood from these sacrifices were gathered and put in an urn that was set near a stone she and Lewis used as an altar. Then she finally came to the section dealing with the final sacrifice. August 9th, 1958. Tonight, vengeance has been mine. Earlier this evening, during the bonfire at Camp Crystal Lake, I found the two counselors who killed my precious boy, and I killed them. After, as Lewis instructed me, I cut out their hearts and gathered as much of their spilled blood as I could with a bucket and sponge. Later, back at the cave at Crystal Hill, I squeezed the remaining blood from the two hearts into a couple canning jars along with the blood I'd gathered in the bucket. When the jars were filled, I poured the remaining blood over the altar. Then I put the two hearts in two large jars filled with formaldehyde. These jars, along with the jars of blood, I took home awaiting word from Lewis about when we can finally finish this ghastly business and bring back my Jason. Bring him back to me. For the next several pages, Micki couldn't help but read Pamela's entries that she wrote during the time she was waiting for Lewis to contact her. Mickey's heart went out to this poor woman as she read of the many plans Pamela had for when she was finally reunited with her son. Then Micki felt an icy chill run through her again when she read the entry when Lewis finally contacted Pamela. August 27th, 1958. I was putting on the laundry on the clothesline when Creighton Duke suddenly appeared behind me again and gave me another start. I still can't figure out how that boy does that. He handed me another note from Lewis. Boldly, I asked him if the time had finally come. The boy simply smiled at me and ran off. Excitedly, I opened the note. Inside, Lewis had wrote instructions on what I needed to bring, and that we were to meet on the shore near the boat launch at Camp Crystal Lake tomorrow night at around 2 in the morning. To my surprise, though Lewis had listed the blood of the two counselors, he had not included the two hearts. Though I'm tempted to bring the hearts as well, I know that I shouldn't, because I must have faith that Lewis wouldn't make such a mistake. Oh, thank you, whoever you are. Tomorrow night will be a night of joy. Tomorrow my Jason will come home. The cold chill remained with Micki, though she didn't know exactly what the next entry would tell. She had a good idea, and she felt sorry for Pamela. Micki started to read the entry, but felt a slow ache in her head. August 29th, 1958. Oh, merciful God in heaven, what have I done? What have I unleashed on the world? Micki stopped reading for a few moments and started rubbing her temples in the hopes of soothing the pain that had crept into her head. Then she noticed what her hand started to feel a little numb as well. God, what's happening to me? She thought. She continued to read. This was the important part. I can't believe that Lewis could purposely deceive me. More than likely, we were both deceived. From what I could tell, Lewis did the ritual exactly the way we'd practiced it. So why did it turn out so wrong? Micki had to stop. Something was terribly wrong with her. The pain in her head was now stabbing, and her hands were cold and nearly numb. She could barely hold the diary now. She tried to yell for Ryan, but the only thing that came out of her mouth was a heavy gasp. Then everything around her started to fade out and turn black. She felt like she was falling. Then she felt a sensation like a light impact, like she had simply fallen out of her chair. Her hands flopped off her lap and landed on dirt. She opened her eyes, though she didn't remember closing them, and saw that she was lying on her side on the ground a short distance from the lake. She also saw she wasn't alone. Right in front of her, standing up to his waist in the lake, was a man in a hooded cloak. Chapter 9, Flashback. Micki watched as the hooded and cloaked man standing in the lake held an ornate-looking gold-colored chalice over his head and began to chant. Most ancient ones, the hooded man chanted in frighteningly familiar voice. I consecrate this place with the offering of the essences of myself and this woman. May this offering show you our diligence and dedication to the work at hand. Micki realized the hooded man was Lewis Vondredy. Turning slowly, the hooded figure of Lewis began dumping the powdered contents of the chalice slowly as he moved. Then, when he was finished, he began to wade to the shore. Noticing some movement to her left, Micki looked over and was startled to see Pamela carrying another gold-colored chalice towards the water to meet Lewis. Once she got there, she retrieved the chalice he was holding and handed him the other. Then she headed back to a nearby folding table where a young black boy stood by yet another chalice. She knew the boy had to be Creighton Duke. Lewis waded out into the lake again. Once he was in position, he held the second chalice over his head and started to chant again. I empower this place with the blood of the animals so that their primal energy may be harnessed and we may be witness to your glorious work this night. Then Lewis dumped the chalice of blood into the lake and started wading back to the shore again. Micki was still in shock over what she was seeing. Somehow, like in Jason's room, she had been transported into the past and was actually witnessing the resurrection of Jason firsthand. She had no doubt she wouldn't be able to change events. Nope, Micki thought. You're simply a witness. When Lewis arrives back at the edge of the water, Pamela was once again there waiting for him with the last chalice. After taking the other one from Lewis, she handed the chalice to him and started wading out into the lake again. And I can guess what's inside this one, Micki thought. Ancient ones, masters of darkness, hear my pleas. Lewis began to chant, Nana Cthulhu Azagatha Lamashta. Show this unfortunate woman that you are greater than the god who has betrayed her. Bring back that which has been taken from her. I ask this with the offering of the blood of vengeance. Then he tipped the chalice and dumped its deep red contents into the water. Slowly and shakily, Micki got up off the ground and watched in amazement as clouds started gathering around the center of the lake. Then, with a flash, a pillar of light shot down from the clouds, just beyond the buoy. The water around the shot began to bubble. Then, as quickly as it came, the light disappeared. There were a few moments of complete silence, like the silence before a storm, but it was broken by the sound of a splash as something came up out of the water. The clouds covered the moon, so all she could make out was a bobbing movement coming towards the shore, though she had no doubt what it was. Micki looked over at Pamela. Pamela was excitedly shifting from one foot to the other. Jason, she said, her eyes tearing. Micki looked over at Lewis, but he seemed frozen in place, watching the bobbing figure. Finally, the figure stopped bobbing and looked to be walking, the water hitting it just below the shoulders.
Oh, Jason, Pamela said excitedly. Oh, I've missed you. Come to Mommy.
It was at that moment the clouds cleared the moon and the lake was bathed in moonlight, and Pamela Voorhees let out a scream when she saw the bloated abomination that was stumbling out of the water towards her. Out of instinct, Micki jumped in front of Pamela before realizing it was a waste of effort. She was just a shadow in this place and couldn't stop anything. But then she was startled as Lewis stepped into the place she was occupying, which caused her to jump out of the way.
Damn, she said, feeling totally weirded out by the experience. I'll never get used to that.
After a few moments, she recovered and watched as Lewis stood his ground, held up his hand, and ordered the thing that had once been Jason to stop. But it had no effect. The putrid-smelling figure continued to stumble up the shore towards his screaming mother. Finally, Lewis turned to Pamela and yelled, Run! That seemed to be all Pamela needed to hear, because she immediately stumbled backwards and took off toward the nearby darkened and abandoned cabins, still screaming hysterically. Good, Micki thought, as she watched Pamela exit. Now I'll be transported back to the kitchen, and I can get away from this nightmare. But to her surprise, as Pamela disappeared from view, nothing happened. She was still left standing on the shore, watching this hideous replay of history. As Micki watched, Lewis dropped his hand, and the excited look on his face dissolved. What replaced it was a cold look of satisfaction. He looked at Jason, who was now enraged and still slowly advancing toward him. Jason, he said in a correcting tone, you will be still. Jason tried to say something back at him, but all that came out of his lips besides a stream of rancid water was a gurgling sound. My dear boy, I understand your pain, Lewis said, giving Jason a saddened look that Micki knew was fake. But you must understand that your mother was not ready for the change that has occurred inside you. The corpse-like creature in front of Lewis stopped and gave him a curious look. I know you haven't realized what has happened, but your mother and I brought you back. You see, there was an accident, and you drowned a year ago to this very day. A spasm went through Jason's twisted body. He turned and stumbled back towards the water again. Then he looked down at his reflection, which was lit by moonlight. Upon seeing it, he let out a gurgling wail that turned into an inhuman scream as the water left his lungs. I know it's horrible, Lewis said, moving over to the figure crouching at the edge of the water. But remember, where there's life, my boy, there is hope. And you are very much alive.
Jason looked up at him and glared at him, pain and shock clearly visible on his bloated features.
Don't worry. Your Uncle Lewis won't desert you, Lewis said. If there is any way I can find to help you, I will.
Jason looked up at him pleadingly.
Mama,
he barely got out.
Your mother?
Lewis asked. Jason nodded.
I'm sorry, son, but you saw her. She'll never accept you as you are.
This initiated a strong reaction from Jason. He slammed his thin, rotten fist into the water, causing mud to come to the surface and obliterate his reflection.
But that might not always be true. Trust me, Lewis told him. You're my family. I won't abandon you.
Jason stood and faced his uncle.
But I need you to accept my help, Lewis said, more demanding. Will you accept my help?
Jason nodded. Lewis looked over at the young Creighton Duke, who was crouched down behind the folding table.
Clean up this mess and meet us at the cave.
The boy cautiously stood up and nodded. Lewis turned back to Jason and said,
Follow me, and I'll take you to a place where you can rest and heal.
Micki watched as Lewis led his ghastly charge up from the edge of the lake and onto the path into the forest.
If I only knew what I know now, Micki heard a female voice say from behind her.
Micki turned around and a figure moved stiffly out of the shadows of the woods. As the figure came into the moonlight, she was struck by both recognition and revulsion. The figure was Pamela Voorhees, but this time it wasn't a vision of the past. This was the ghost of Pamela Voorhees. As the figure, who was dressed in a blood-soaked tan turtleneck sweater and equally soaked blue jeans, moved closer, Micki could see that her head was severed at the throat and was being balanced on the stump of the neck by pure will. New blood dribbled from the slice in the neck.
Please don't be frightened, my dear, Mrs. Voorhees said. I'm really trying to make myself as presentable as possible. As long as I stay straight and the suction holds, we won't have an uncomfortable accident.
You're the one who brought me here? Micki realized.
Yes, I did, Pamela admitted.
Why? Micki asked, standing her ground, though part of her wanted to run as far as she could from this walking dead woman.
I need you to know the truth, the whole truth, Pamela said, stopping 3 feet away from Micki.
But I had your diaries, Micki started to say, but Pamela cut her off.
Those don't tell the full story, Pamela said. If only I knew then what I do now, I could have stopped all the bloodshed. It took my own death to really open my eyes to my dear brother's treachery. He used me and cursed my son to this horrible, endless existence.
Micki was perplexed by this turn of events.
If I recall, wasn't it just 1.5 years ago that Jason's mask brought your head back to life? Micki reminded her. And from what my research indicated, you were helping the mask.
Pamela looked taken aback.
What the mask brought back in that soulless thing was the madness my sin had drawn me into. I was forced to sit helplessly and watch Lewis and the Dark Ones use my remains like some perverted puppet.
That sounds like a convenient story, Micki said, her distrust evident. Now you seem perfectly able to take action.
Well, that's thanks to you, dear, she said. You seem unaware of the power you possess. I sensed it the moment you walked into my house. I've been tapping into it to help me do this.
You showed me that vision in Jason's room?
Micki recalled.
You nearly got me killed. You needed to have proof about Lewis, Pamela reminded her. Anyway, I trusted that your cousin would be able to help you.
Still, How am I supposed to trust you after all the horrible things you've done?
I can understand your reluctance, Pamela said, looking hurt. All I ask is that you look at what I have to show you with an open mind.
There's more? Micki said, surprised.
Oh, yes, dear, Pamela said. At that moment, the lake and campground dissolved and were replaced by cave walls, glowing in candlelight.
What the? Micki said.
As I said, there is more for you to see, Pamela informed her.
Micki looked around the cave and understood where she was, inside the cave on Crystal Hill. But the question was when. She saw Lewis standing over a crouching figure dressed in blue jean coveralls and a flannel shirt. Standing nearby as well was Creighton Duke, though now he looked to be about 17.
Look at me when I'm talking to you, Lewis said sternly to the crouching figure.
Please, master, don't punish him. I was the one who didn't keep a good enough eye on him, Creighton Duke said with his head lowered.
Don't worry, you'll get yours, Lewis said, glaring at him. But now I must convince our rebellious little charge here of the error of his ways.
Hearing this, Jason glared up at Lewis, giving Micki a clear view of his fully healed yet hideously deformed face. His facial features seemed scrunched together, with sporadic patches of stringy black hair covering his nearly bald scalp. His most prominent features were his jutting discolored teeth and his drooping right eye, which gave the impression of being lower than the other.
Can't you understand the danger you put yourself into by going off on your own like that? Lewis told him. What if someone saw you?
Jason looked up with defiance in his good eye. He said back. Lewis closed his eyes and calmed his frustration. When he spoke again, his voice was calm and soothing.
I know you miss your mother, but you have to understand that your mother won't accept you the way you are. Please understand me. It's been 5 years, and she's moved on with her life. She even has another child to love.
This put Jason into a rage. He gave an inhuman roar of anger and began pounding on the cave wall. Then he turned to Lewis, fire in his good eye. He lifted his arms above his head and let out another roar. Lewis looked unimpressed.
You hurt me, boy, and you'll be alone.
Jason froze for a moment. A look of fear came into his good eye. Then he turned around and started pounding on the cave wall again.
I know it's a painful realization for you, Lewis said, sounding a little bit sympathetic, but it's a fact of life.
Jason screamed. Lewis stood back and watched as Jason continued. After a few more minutes, he finally slumped down and began to cry. His fist, which he held tightly across his stomach, were a cut-up mess. Dark, blackish-colored blood oozed from the wounds.
Clean him up, Lewis ordered Creighton Duke. And this time, keep an eye on him, or the next person in need of the first aid kit will be you.
Lewis glared at him in a way that made it perfectly clear he wasn't joking.
But, Master, where are you going? The boy asked, nervously looking over at Jason's slumped form.
I need to do some cleanup work of my own. It's obvious something needs to be done, something final. It appears we're going to have to advance things a bit sooner than I would like, but we've no choice.
Are you sure that's wise? Creighton Duke said. It's true his rage has continued to grow, but I don't believe it's strong enough to push him into murder.
With that, Lewis slapped Creighton Duke across the face. The slap was hard enough that it knocked the boy to the ground.
I didn't ask for your approval or your opinion. I think leaving you here to watch our charge has given you an inflated view of your position here.
The boy crawled to Lewis and got into a kneeling position in front of him.
I ask forgiveness, Master.
Once you clean him up, pack our things and be ready to leave.
Lewis ordered, his voice lowered so Jason couldn't hear him. It won't be safe for either of us around here once the plan is executed. Micki looked over at the ghost of Pamela Voorhees, surprised.
What plan? I demand to know what we're... How we're seeing this. You couldn't possibly have known about this.
But I could. She heard a male voice say from behind her. Micki turned and saw a tall, slim, middle-aged black man, decked out in cowboy boots, blue jean pants, dark flannel shirt, blue jean vest, and a black cowboy hat, come out of the shadows. The man also had a dark mustache and whiskers, with several gray hairs in the mix.
Creighton Duke? Micki said, stating the obvious.
At your service, lovely lady. The black man in the cowboy hat said, with a toothy grin and a tip of his hat. My reputation precedes me.
What the hell are you doing here? Micki asked.
The same thing as poor Pamela here, he told her. You saw for yourself. I also was involved in bringing Jason back, and I share the same punishments. I, too, will never find rest until this curse is ended.
It was Creighton who made me aware of all this. He showed me the same way that I'm showing you now, Pamela told Micki. I don't understand this. You helped Jessica and Ryan send Jason to hell? Micki said to Duke, surprised by his turn of events.
Obviously, that wasn't enough, Duke said.
But now we've got a chance to redeem ourselves, thanks to you and your cousin, Pamela told her.
Micki felt overwhelmed. Now she had the fate of these two souls added to the burden she already held.
Lewis said something about a plan he was having to advance, Micki said, looking over at the two spirits, who were now standing together in front of her.
With that, the scene around her dissolved yet again. Chapter 10, The Morning After. Ryan smelled the aroma of fresh coffee as he drowsily and stiffly limped down the hall toward the kitchen. His body still hurt from the beating it had taken the night before. He silently chided himself for oversleeping. It was well after 9, and he knew he needed to get himself together and take care of a few things. One thing he definitely needed to do was call his partner, Will Peters, and ask him if he could take care of the Army-Navy store for the next few days. He figured he'd explain his need for time away from the store by telling his partner he wanted to spend some time with his cousin, which wasn't far from the truth, though he couldn't rightly tell him what he and his cousin were going to be doing together. Upon entering the kitchen, Ryan grabbed a mug from behind the sink and poured himself a steaming cup of coffee. Thankful, the auto shutoff on the coffee maker was broken. He was just taking his first eye-opening sip when he turned and saw Micki slumped over the top of the kitchen table, fast asleep. Her head was resting on an open volume of Pamela Voorhees' diaries. As he headed over to check on her, she started to stir. Groaning sleepily, she looked up at him with squinty eyes.
What time is it?
She asked, sitting up and wiping a bit of drool from the side of her mouth.
It's a bit past 9, he said. Were you up most of the night reading those?
He indicated the majority of the diaries, which were strewn on the floor next to the table.
I guess I must have been, she said, looking down at the scattered pile of books. But Ryan, something happened last night. I talked with the spirit of Pamela Voorhees herself and Creighton Duke.
Creighton Duke? Ryan parroted back at her. Are you sure it wasn't just a very detailed dream?
It felt like the experience I had at the Voorhees house. You can't explain that away as being only a dream.
Ryan had to admit she had a point, yet he still couldn't take her word for it. How do you know it was Duke?
Besides the fact that he introduced himself, I don't know too many black guys these days who could get away with that urban cowboy dress style. Hell, the guy reminded me of Mr. Nightlinger from the Cowboys.
Ryan was startled by her terminology. He had thought of that character from the John Wayne movie when he first met Creighton Duke.
I know exactly how Lewis and Pamela brought Jason back from the dead, she told him. Then she yawned and sleepily rubbed her eyes.
That's fantastic, he told her, and I'd love to hear about it.
But right now, I think it would be for the best if you went upstairs and got a few hours sleep. She looked at him, surprised.
What? But, Ryan, I have to tell you what I found out.
Micki, you're exhausted, Ryan told her. You're no good to either one of us like this. Micki tried to argue, but Ryan waved her off. Anyway, I've got some urgent business in town, and while I'm out, I expect you to get some rest.
But Ryan, this is important, she pressed.
I promise we will sit down when I get back, and you can go over it with me to your heart's content. But right now, I have a business to worry about.
Your store? Micki said, the realization hitting her. What are you going to do?
I was just about to call my partner when I saw you.
You think he'll be willing to help you out? She asked.
I'm sure, he assured her. Will ran that store for 10 years before he took me on as a partner and went into semi-retirement. I'm sure he'll be itching to get his hands dirty again.
Then I guess I've got no choice, Micki admitted,
though she didn't seem completely secure with it.
But the moment you get home, you're going to sit down and listen.
Cross my heart, I promise, he said, giving her a two-fingered scout salute. Then he escorted her upstairs. He was about to hang out and make sure she actually went to bed, but he didn't have to. The moment her head hit the pillow, Micki was fast asleep. Ryan headed downstairs and went into the kitchen again. After refilling his coffee cup, he went to the white phone on the wall, picked up the receiver, and dialed Will Peters' number. After a few rings, he heard drum music playing in the background as Will's answering machine message came on.
You've reached the residence of retired Army Colonel William Charles Peters. I am.
Then there was a click.
Hello?
Said a slightly out of breath Will Peters.
Will? Ryan asked.
Hey, Stephen, Will said, sounding better. You caught me just as I got home from my jog. What's up?
I was wondering if you could watch the store for me for a couple days.
You need some reacquainting time with that lovely cousin of yours, Will asked, surprising Ryan.
How?
Ryan asked.
This is Crystal Lake, Will told him as if that explained everything.
But then he added,
very little happens around here that people don't know.
So what do you say about the store? Ryan asked.
Sure, Will said. I'd love to take care of the old girl for a couple days.
After that, they agreed to meet at the store in 45 minutes. After Ryan hung up the phone, he drank down his coffee and rushed upstairs to get dressed.
Wake up, fool! The voice screamed in Phil Raymond's head.
What?
Phil said, quickly setting up from behind the clump of brush he was laying behind. Due to pain his hunger for the mask caused him, Phil had barely managed to relax enough to go to sleep in the first place. Now that he'd been jarred awake, the pain nauseated him to the point where he nearly threw up.
Freeman's leaving, the voice informed him. We must follow him.
Bleary-eyed, Raymond looked over at the house and saw Freeman heading down the path toward the blue truck.
Hurry, we must get back to the car before he gets away.
Phil didn't argue. He knew even if he wanted to, it would be unwise to provoke the voice. So he slipped through the bushes, trying not to be noticed. Once he was out of sight of the house, he forced himself to start running through the woods toward his car's hiding place.
Damn it, if he gets away, I'll make you suffer for it, the voice threatened as he ran. I'm doing the best I can, damn you,
Phil cursed back, though he wanted to laugh. He doubted the voice could hurt him any more than he felt at the moment, but he didn't want to bet on it. Then he caught sight of the back of his car in the distance. He also saw Freeman's truck speeding down the dirt road not too far behind him. Freeman's truck had just passed his car's hiding place, the dust cloud still heavy in the air, when Phil finally reached the hiding place. After rummaging around his pants pockets for the car keys for a few moments, Phil opened the car door, jumped inside, and started the engine. The engine groaned unhappily but didn't die. Slowly, Phil backed the car out of the bushes and took off down the road after Freeman's truck.
Hurry up, the voice pushed.
We don't want Freeman to see us, Phil reminded the voice. We don't want to lose him either, the voice said back.
Don't worry. I know what I'm doing, Phil said, as he turned off the dirt road onto the main road.
Freeman's truck was barely visible in the distance.
You'd better be very sure about that, the voice said, for your own sake.
Phil sped up the car a bit, but still kept Freeman's truck a good distance away. He kept this up all the way into town.
I must say you've done wonders with this place, Will Peters said as he counted out the till.
Ryan was standing on the other side of the cash register watching him. Even after 2 hours, he still hadn't got used to seeing his former boss wearing a light blue jogging suit. In the 10 years he'd known Will Peters, he'd never seen him wear anything but military clothing. Even when he was Ryan's best man at his wedding, Will wore his dress blues.
But then you always were the idea man, eh, Stephen? Will continued.
If I recall, that wasn't always an attribute you admired about me, Ryan reminded him.
Yes, it took some time, but you wore me down, Will said, laughing with amusement at the reminiscence. But I must say, I'm surprised that you'd get on the bandwagon, so to speak, and have anything to do with all this Jason rubbish.
Ryan was confused for a moment, but then he realized what Will was getting at. On the wall behind the main counter, near the door to the back stock, was a display of knives. Among the knives was a machete with the name Crystal Lake painted in drippy-looking blood-red letters on the blade. Ryan looked over at the machete and waved it off.
Oh yeah, that thing. The thing is, I have the same distributor as Ross McCade at the Crystal Lake Souvenir Shop. So when I last restocked, I got stuck with those. The distributor promised to replace them as soon as he gets some regular ones in.
Good. I would have been very disappointed in you, Will said with relief. Especially after everything that has happened.
Hey, Will, you know me better than that.
I don't know about that, Will said seriously. Mary at the coffee shop was telling me that you and your cousin were asking Betty about Pamela Voorhees.
Actually, it was Micki who was doing the asking, Ryan admitted. She's doing research for a book on Pamela Voorhees.
Oh, really? Will said, seeming a bit overly interested. So, brains as well.
This last comment caught Ryan by surprise.
Well, it was a smart idea to take her to Betty, Will continued.
Yeah, I figured since Betty is the big ear around town, she'd definitely know something.
Actually, I meant because Betty was one of Pamela's best friends. Her and Ralph were closer to Pamela and Elias than anyone in this town. That includes the Christies.
What do you mean? Ryan asked, confused. According to everything he'd heard, it was the Christies the Voorhees had been close friends with.
Though Pamela and Elias may have acted cozy with the Christies in public, the truth was both of them thought the Christies were stuck-up snobs. The only one Pamela had any affection for was Steve Christie, and you know how that ended.
Ryan nodded. He definitely did remember reading about how the sheriff found Steve Christie's mercilessly butchered body hanging from the branch of a tree near the main cabin.
Anyway, Ralph and Betty were constantly over at the Voorhees house, Will continued. In the old days, you always saw Elias and Ralph together, either going fishing or hunting.
That's odd, because Betty gave me the impression she barely knew Pamela, Ryan told him.
It's probably a very sensitive issue with her. I recall she and Pamela went their separate ways after Elias had his accident.
Ryan looked at Will. His curiosity piqued.
I've heard the story about how Pamela died, but I've never heard about what happened to Elias. You said it was an accident?
Yeah, Elias and Ralph were out hunting. It was right after we had 4 days straight of rain, Will told him. An old tree tipped over on top of him, and he was impaled through the heart by a broken branch.
And no one questioned the story?
Ryan asked, surprised.
It sounds a bit fishy to me, man. I thought the same thing when I heard it the first time. But the sheriff at the time did an investigation and confirmed Ralph's story.
Still, the story didn't ring true to Ryan. He figured there had to be more to it.
Oddly enough, it wasn't long after Elias's death that Ralph started drinking, preaching, and claiming that Camp Crystal Lake had a death curse,
Will added.
And what about Pamela? Ryan asked.
From what I heard after the accident, Pamela became more reclusive. It was less than a year later that she had her breakdown and was committed.
I hadn't heard Pamela had been committed, Ryan had to admit. So that's why Diana was raised by the Kimballs.
Pamela only got out of the institution 3 years before she committed the murders at Camp Crystal Lake, Will told him. I'm surprised you didn't know.
If you recall, my mom and I moved to Crystal Lake just a few years after the murders, Ryan reminded him. By that time, the townspeople were very closed-mouthed about anything dealing with Pamela Voorhees.
Phil Raymond leaned against the wall next to the display window of the Army-Navy store, drinking a cup of coffee out of a paper cup and eating a chocolate cupcake he'd gotten from the grocery store across the street. The voice in his head had been very angry with him for leaving his post, just to stuff his face. But Phil had been extremely hungry. The last time he'd eaten had been just after he and Dr. Bob had returned from the murder scene at Crystal Hill, nearly 40 hours earlier.
Satisfied now? The voice asked.
Phil dropped the cupcake wrapper on the ground and pulled the Ziploc bag out of his coat pocket that held the two pickled eggs he'd bought as well.
Nearly,
he said aloud, bending down and putting his coffee cup on the small ledge under the display window. Then he opened the bag and one by one downed the two eggs. He hardly chewed and let the sour-tasting delicacy slide down his throat.
Breakfast, he said with a satisfied groan. I hope it was worth it to you, the voice said with disgust. Be thankful Freeman was still here when you returned. You definitely wouldn't have enjoyed the alternative.
Phil bent down and retrieved his cup of coffee.
Think of it this way. I wouldn't be of much use to the plan if I let myself become weak from being hungry.
So there you are, he heard someone say from behind him. Startled, Phil turned and hot coffee from his cup sloshed over his hand. He yelped and dropped the cup, sending its contents splattering on the ground in front of him.
My God, man, what have you done to yourself? Sheriff Landis said as he approached.
I'm fine, Phil said, rubbing his red and stinging hand.
The burn looked worse than it was, but it would still be an irritant to him.
Have you looked at yourself lately? You look like shit.
The sheriff sounded almost concerned.
I haven't been feeling good, Phil told him,
allowing a trace of the irritation he felt to come through.
Is there some reason for your visit, Sheriff?
Sheriff Landis seemed slightly annoyed.
Actually, there is. Your boss has been looking for you. If you recall, you're supposed to be helping him with the autopsies of those kids from the latest set of murders.
I told you, Sheriff, I'm not feeling good. The only reason I'm out of bed right now is because I needed to get something in my stomach.
Well, boy, you really need to get on the horn and let Bob know, the sheriff informed him. He told me he'd been calling your place and paging you all day yesterday.
Fine, I'll call him, Phil said, annoyed. Is there anything else?
Just that you should go see the doctor before what you have turns serious.
I'm hoping it will,
Phil said under his breath.
What was that? The sheriff said.
I said I'll look into it. Phil lied.
You do that,
the sheriff said, turning around and starting back to his patrol car, which was parked at the corner. Phil watched him leave and imagined how satisfying it would be to stick a knife in that loudmouth jackass's back.
In time, my friend, the voice said. In time.
So since your cousin is researching a book, she'll probably be hanging around for a bit, Will said with a nervous grin as he walked Ryan to the front door of the store.
Is there something you wanted to ask me about Micki?
Ryan asked.
You've been acting like a high school boy wanting to ask the most popular girl to the prom.
I have?
Will said, his face turning crimson with embarrassment.
Actually, I was interested in finding out if she'd be around for the winter festival.
I'd be very interested in asking if she'd allow me to escort her to the winter ball. This totally blew Ryan away. Will and Micki on a date? But then Ryan realized that there wasn't all that much difference in Micki and Will ages. He realized he'd been seeing Micki through the blinders of his past. The truth was that while he had grown up all over again, Micki had aged 18 years. She was now a 50-year-old woman. "I'll definitely ask her about it," Ryan said finally.
"Thank you, Steve," Will said, a look of relief on his face.
"So where are you off to now?"
"To do a little research of my own," Ryan said as he headed out the door.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been chapters 8, 9, and 10 of Friday the 13th, The Mask of Jason Voorhees by Eric Morse. What do you guys think so far? You know, I had my reservations about all these different things being tied together. The book series, Jason Goes to Hell, and the TV series. But I gotta say, this book has kept me intrigued and entertained. I'm really enjoying it. I really liked how they explained the stuff about Pamela and her first set of murders at Crystal Lake. You know, and then apparently, I'm guessing she committed the second set after she got out of the institution, like was mentioned in this chapter. I feel like some more of that's going to be explained later by Pamela's spirit and everything to fill in the gaps. I know some people aren't going to dig the whole paranormal aspect to the story with the spirits and everything and the Necronomicon, but in Jason Goes to Hell, the Necronomicon was in the Voorhees' house. And you better believe if that exists in that world, so do spirits. So I'm perfectly fine with the spirits. In fact, I'm loving it that Creighton Duke is back in some form or fashion. But yeah, guys, I'm really excited moving forward. I'm really enjoying the story of Steven slash Ryan and Micki, you know, the whole Friday the 13th TV series thing with Louis Vondredy being connected to Pamela Voorhees from the movie series and Creighton Duke from Jason Goes to Hell. And I'm really excited to see what happens next. And I'll be back very soon to let you know what happens next when I return with more of Friday the 13th, The Mask of Jason Voorhees. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, and you better finish this book for me, because like Crazy Ralph said,
it's got a death curse!
Hi. This is William Pattison, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris, and you are watching the 80s Slasher Librarian's narration of my book, The Mask of Jason Voorhees. Yeah. Enjoy.